evening, Celonis fans, and welcome back to Celosphere. We're here in wonderful Munich, Germany. My name is Savannah Peterson, joined with my fabulous co-host, Rob Strechay, for our final and perhaps most fascinating segment of the day. Before we introduce our guest, who needs no introduction, Rob, what's the coolest thing you learned today?
I think it's how the process intelligence graph and how it brings together a lot of different pieces from the models to the actual, how the process is actually being implemented and all the different deviations from it. But going from strings to things is kind of really the key out of that.
Yeah, I think it's just been absolutely fascinating. Here to conclude our fantastic day of programming is the man who kicked it all off this morning. Alex, what a keynote today. That was fantastic. I loved the music from the different eras.
It was really nice. Yeah, come and try to dance on sticks. That's still dangerous. You know what?
I mean, the fact that you went for it, though.
It's not my sweet spot, but it was fun.
I thought it was great. I thought you brought a lot of authenticity to the stage and a lot of great stories to the stage, a lot of great examples. How did it feel for you to be up there looking at 3,000 of your favorite community members and the energy in that room?
Well, you know, I always think that's a huge reward, right? Hugely rewarding, super exciting because those are, you know, our customers, our partners, a lot of our Celonauts are there. And it's like, you know, one of the best days for me of the whole year. You know, it's like Christmas and birthday combined. You know, it's like, and seeing the energy, seeing the enthusiasm, seeing the customer stories. It was amazing.
No. I think what was fun is we actually got to go to a little bit of the partner day, and you were up on stage and we were talking about how you're 400 worldwide partners now, and I have a funny feeling that's going to grow.
Oh, yeah.
Because we look at this and feel free to expound on this, is that without, you know, process intelligence, really, it's near impossible to do AI and to do AI agents, right?
100%. Well, you know, we always say no AI without PI. Mm-hmm. Especially not on the enterprise side. But what's the difference between AI and enterprise AI? Well, enterprise AI needs to understand something like the enterprise, right? And each enterprise is different. You have proprietary processes, customer relationships, vendor relationships, and all that scattered in a lot of different systems that were implemented over the years. You know, different data models, they don't speak the same language. And process intelligence allows you to stitch together a consistent process layer, a semantic layer, really, or if you want to say a common language. And that's what our process intelligence graph does. Essentially, it's the data, it's also the context, right? All the KPIs, metrics, what's late, what's on time, what are our designs, what are our models, what are the responsibilities and the roles in the company. And that is really, really important and foundational to make agents work, because if the agents don't know how your business flows, they can't automate for you, they can't execute for you, they can't help you. And that's what we see with real customers every day. So we think that's very exciting.
Speaking of those customers that are benefiting from your wonderful ecosystem that we got to hear about on stage, lots of value realized.
Right.
Just in case folks weren't in the room at the keynote, could you give us some highlights from that?
Well, I think one highlight was Pfizer, because they shared that they started at 100 million 2 years ago. I mean, that's where they got to 5 years ago. Last year, they were at 205 million. Today, over 320 million in value realized. That's pretty big numbers, even for a big organization. You know, there was Exxon, you know, when they think about value, they said that they think in very big ways about value. They're a huge organization. So there was lots of those examples. But it's not just the monetary value, right? Northwestern, big provider of healthcare in the U.S., they talk about how they reduce how long patients have to be in the hospital. And that kind of, you know, it touches a much broader opportunity. Of course, that's going to take cost out of delivering healthcare, but it's also going to improve people's lives. So I think there's so much value. You know, we talk about the fact that processes, people don't know this, obviously people at Celonis do, but maybe people on the IT screen still need to learn about this, are the greatest level for value and the fastest level for change in an organization. It's something you control, you can change, you can do something about, and that's what we're here to help with.
So you must, I mean, as, you know, again, you're out there as co-CEO having conversations all the time, probably with your peers at these companies.
Right.
What where did they get to? And they must be asking you, saying, hey, you're building AI. You have your own. You're allowing us to use platforms from the cloud providers and others. And you're not forcing us out of things or lock in. They must be also looking at that and saying, hey, how do we really achieve AI faster? Yeah. You know, what do we need to do that? What are kind of some of the hints that you give?
Right. I mean, I think really it's about creating this foundational layer, right? Because the models are going to get better, and they have room to go, right? They can do some things already, but, you know, they get better every year. They're going to get better. But do you have the foundations in place? Do you have a common language to store your process knowledge? Because if you don't, how is the AI model going to understand you?
Yeah.
Do you have a common process intelligence graph across the different systems to capture the data so that when you, for example, want to understand, show me all the processes that are running for a customer. You can pull that with one API call, right, in one common language. Those are the things that you need to do now. By the way, they pay for themselves because they can drive huge value in itself, getting that visibility. There's AI you can implement today. We have a lot of customers we talk about, we can get into that, and you talk to, that are driving AI agents on top of Celonis, and they also prepare for the future, because the better the models get, the easier it's going to get, the more use cases you're going to have. So that's really important. Don't miss that, because if you miss that, it's going to be piecemeal, it's not going to be strategic, it's going to be very expensive, it's going to be brittle.
Right.
One of the things that I was really struck by, I had the pleasure of having dinner with one of your data scientists last night.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, which was actually a complete and total coincidence, but okay. And wonderfully insightful. Something you said that struck me was that your business really stretches across different verticals and business models, and no sector having more than 10% saturation in terms of your market share and value. How do you make sure that you're designing a product that can fix everything from healthcare to financial to manufacturing out in the field all around the world in many different languages in different countries?
An excellent question, Savannah. And, well, that's really what being a platform means, right? That it can be used for many different things. And the platform can be used in any process, but there's a similarity. It's always about process. And in the technical terms, the process is objects like invoices and orders and customers, or it could be patients and X-ray machines, and, you know, but those objects, and then there's events, all the events that move through the process. And we define a generic model so that you can capture any process in Celonis. But we want to make it easier for any industry and any process to get exposed to Celonis and get value out of the box. So we have apps that we build for specific use cases, like accounts payable, receivables, like supply chain, that are quite horizontal, but we are enabling our partners to build apps on top of our platforms. They are bringing their industry-specific knowledge and experience to the platform, and they build apps. There were some amazing apps that have been launched here on Celosphere. We're going to launch apps every quarter that are doing things like cross-border payments, VAT tax compliance, things, business challenges that Celonis doesn't even know about, but our partners do, and they have productizing this on top of the process intelligence graph so that customers can benefit from a whole ecosystem of solutions ready to drive value quickly.
I love that you brought up the partners. I think sometimes it can be vague how partners power a platform. For example, you have over 400 partners, if I heard you correctly, in the keynote. And that really is a competitive advantage, but a real true customer satisfaction driver when you have these experts in each one of these verticals. So that's how you're able to catch up. One of the other things that I couldn't help but notice everywhere that both touched my heart as a technologist, but also as a citizen of this planet, is the emphasis on sustainability. Yes. The constant messaging that the Earth is our future. I love the Mars stuff that I've seen around. Very well done to your design team and your marketing team. But I'm really excited to ask you here at the helm, why is sustainability so core to everything you're doing at Celonis?
Well, I think it's a real challenge, obviously, but it's also an opportunity, right, to drive change and motivate change and motivate action. And process visibility, you know, we always say it can help you on the top line, it can help you on the bottom line, and it can help you on the green line. And, you know, for example, we have a great customer. They do a packaging steel, basically, just in Crop Russell's time, and a big company. And they looked at all of their supply chain and distribution network, right? Because as you can imagine, that's heavy stuff that they have to ship. So, it's a heavy logistics footprint. And they look at it, of course, from an efficiency perspective, but they also look at every step and how much carbon emissions have created. So they could take actual steps to reduce their carbon footprint. There's lots of stories like that, a lot more coming, and that's inspiring our customers, our people, and everybody to drive positive change across all those dimensions. And there's going to be more of that.
Yeah. I think also tying back to your comment on your actual partners, and one of the things that I loved out of the keynote this morning was the discussion of network and
how connecting
it's a network, it's not a portal.
Right.
I mean, to me, that rang so true. I remember the days of EDI and, like, really, you know, and then, okay, we'll package some RPA on top of it, and it's very static and fragile and great.
So
help people understand what you meant by, you know, the process network.
Well, we had this idea a couple of years ago, and I've been working on this sort of with some early customers, and now was the moment to, you know, communicate it more broadly. And the idea is the following. So Celonis initially was one process at a time, case-centric process mining. Then we moved to object-centric, which allows you to go one process at a time, but cross processes as well. Let's say you have this graph that connects all your processes together. Well, when you do that, you notice in the supply chain, your processes don't stop within your company. They extend into your distribution network. They extend into your supply network. So when you, for example, have lead times, and you have the wrong lead times, at least professionally on the customer side, because they might get your order too late, on the supply side, it leads to friction on the customer side because you can't ship the product on time. Worst case, it leads to downtimes, etc. So we started working with customers that had Celonis already deployed, and we knew we're working together, like Conrad Electronics, Schuckert Electronics. There's a whole cluster now. And we said, hey, why don't we connect Celonis to Celonis? Because you have this common language. It doesn't matter whether you use Oracle, SAP, whatever you use for your systems. You have a common language. We can connect it together. And we can actually discover the friction points in your processes that go cross-company. And that's led to this whole network that we built, that we launched in beta. And, you know, according to the booth, they got a lot of sign-ups and a lot of interest. This has tons of friction and processes between companies, and we think we can really provide some real value there.
Yeah, I mean, I think to me, the big word about a year and a half ago was data clean rooms and things like this. To me, this is a better approach to what people were trying to achieve. Not exactly the same thing, but it solves for, hey, I want actions that I need to understand and have that visibility across that entire supply chain.
Oh, 100%. It provides visibility across systems, right, and allows people to network, and it makes ultimately the processes in those systems better, right? It just enhances things. It didn't replace anything that you are doing today. It just makes it better. And the point that you made on data clean rooms, I think if you have like a specific use case where you need to share like one data set, that's a great approach. But if it's about process network and cross-company process, I think then we have the right approach. So we think that's very complementary.
Yeah, and I don't, to your point, I think they're complementary in fact, because you may have a process that needs a set of data in a clean room or something like that. So,
I think that's a great point. I know you had a chat with John on the New York Stock Exchange floor just last week, actually. It's my understanding that you're also Germany's number one unicorn, $13 billion valuation, probably more than that now at this stage since the last time you raised. Curious, since you have a moment, I know there's a lot of German entrepreneurs very inspired by you. What's your advice to someone just starting out right now? Lots of hype around AI, lots of excitement around business optimization, but even more than that, what would you tell every German entrepreneur who wants to be you today?
Yeah, I mean, look, I think that first of all, we had a lot of luck as well, right? Like having that serendipity of the right team with the right idea turned out to be a great idea at a good point in time, right? So really, I think if you want to start a company, you need to feel very good about your team. You need to feel very good about your ability to work together for a long period of time. This takes a long time. You know?
Incredible point that people often forget. It's at least a decade.
Especially in enterprise. You know,
exactly.
It's like 6 years to get to, I think after 6 years, we're still under 100 employees. Just think about that, right? Like, it's not, you know, you push three buttons and suddenly you're viral.
That's right. Yeah.
Hard work.
No, people like to think it is.
Yeah, yeah. That's also not easy, right? A lot of people try it. So I'm not saying it's easy to start a consumer company, but just in B2B, it's going to take you a long time. And then, you know, having something that you're really passionate about, like we have really been passionate about this technology, about the impact, et cetera, and then you can do it from anywhere, right? You don't, you know, there's companies, great companies, entrepreneurs come from different parts of the world now, companies start in different parts of the world, and then, you know, something's very obvious, but that helped us a lot. The early days, we were bootstrap. Don't mean you have to do that, but what it helped us to do is we focused on our customers intensely all the time, right? So I see, especially with this AI hype, there's some risks there as well, that you might get so excited about the technology that you're building technology for technology purposes, but you forget the most important piece, that's the customer. The customer ultimately doesn't care how the value gets delivered. They want to see real tangible impact. So those would be a couple of thoughts.
Yeah, I think just playing off of that, I think, you know, focus. You know, I've been at a few startups myself and had some different exits, and some were successful, but some were less. But one of the things is focus, and I think what also struck me out of the keynote earlier today was Celosphere and really how you've really focused on improving and improving. To me, it had more than just, you know, how fast, you know, when Vivia was going through how much improvement was happening for customers, which is fantastic, but it also has the sustainability aspect where it's more efficient in how it's using things. Do you look at, I mean, that must be a push from your customers as well, if you're working backwards and forwards.
Yeah, we always, whenever we come up with a new data infrastructure to be more scalable or we make it better, customers stretch it, right? Because they want to have more data and closer to real time, and this is really embracing, and we also worked on this for a couple of years under the hood, a very modern data stack that's very interoperable with, you know, any of the data lakes. You can move data into it very fast. It can operate on your data, and it's extremely fast and scalable, you know, because we have customers like a big pharmacy group in the U.S. that came to us and said, we kind of want to basically take every product we sell and every movement from one shelf, every reservation, et cetera, and kind of look at those processes in real time. You know, you're talking tens of billions.
This is a daunting statement.
You know, it's like, all right, let's do it, right? And so you always have these customers that really push you, and we're pretty excited about it because it allows us to go into more domains, right? Because, for example, in the front office, you often have very different data volumes, and we can do that now.
I love it. All right, I've got two more questions for you this evening. We got into a very interesting discussion with Rudy before you got up here. And I'm curious, you're a golfer, you're a Star Wars fan, you're a cat dad. So like your entire team, I am personally obsessed with efficiency to the point where it physically hurts my mind if I see systems that are inefficient, and I have to often excuse myself from situations. Also could be extended or spicy. What in your life is a process that you have hyper-optimized in your personal life outside of the platform?
Well, I would say I got pretty good at traveling.
You know, I was going to be
going to the airport, you know, not spending too much time at the airport, but also not missing your flight. So I would say I got pretty good at that. I got pretty good at, you know, knowing exactly in order to play 9 hours of golf, for example, like, you know, how much time I need, and, you know, going very fast, you know, so if I have to, because that's just, you know, a good way for me to switch off. So that would be true. I think, you know, managing the cats, we have two. That's maybe something I'm still evolving, you know?
That is always things. That's a great example.
Dogs are far easier. You can optimize for the dogs.
I love dogs. I used to be in high school. I used to be a dog instructor. I worked in a dog school.
The cats are just there to constantly keep you thinking of ways to optimize Celonis. It's always keep you on your toes. You never know what's going to happen next. All right, last and final question for your brilliance. At next Celosphere, what do you hope to be able to say that you can't yet say today?
Oh, that's very interesting. Well, I'd love to talk about the ecosystem we can talk about today, but those, you know, a lot more of those great examples. I think that's really something that is growing very fast. You know, having more proof points around some of the very, very bleeding edge stuff that we are doing, you know, we talked about a process intelligence graph has landed, right? So we saw lots of improvements. That was last year, it was new.
Yeah.
Right? So the things that are new this year, I want to have proven out last year. And then there's a few surprises that I want to spill right now to make sure everybody comes back and you guys come in. Something we have under the hood, you know? Some things are cooking.
We love to hear it, honestly, and I don't say this lightly. This has been one of the coolest conferences I've ever been to. We've learned so much. Your team has done an absolutely outstanding job. Right. The brand is 10 out of 10. And quite frankly, I think everyone here can sense what a rocket ship you are and what a moment you're having. So we can't wait to come back and tell those stories.
You know, I'm a big fan of theCUBE. I love the work that you guys are doing, and you look forward to being back then.
Thanks so much for taking the time on the busiest day of the year. Rob, always a treat to sit here. And thank all of you for tuning in to our 14 fantastic segments here in Munich, Germany. Celonis, Celosphere. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.